So Chris Elphick is a professor of conservation biology in the Department of Ecology and Evolutionary Biology at the University of Connecticut. His research centers around describing, understanding, and mitigating biodiversity loss. He has been studying coastal marsh birds and their habitats since 2002, and his lab is home to a variety of other research projects, including studies of bird conservation in agricultural settings, patterns of global insect declines, and the consequences of forest fragmentation. He is also one of the lead investigators for the Connecticut Bird Atlas, which draws on the efforts of hundreds of volunteer bird watchers to gather data describing the state's avifauna. So I would very much like for you to join me in welcoming our keynote speaker, Chris Elphick.
Turning over there, but not here.
Oh. All right, let's just start it from the beginning, shall we? I'm glad I stopped early.
Okay, so this is not a cheerful story. I will warn you that up front. It's a story about climate change and how, you know, climate change is happening. It's happening in dramatic ways. It's changing lots of things about the world. It's causing things to move around in unexpected ways. And just as we have to adapt to deal with it, so do all the other organisms that we share the planet with. And so a lot of what we're doing in this work is trying to understand how these birds that live in coastal marshes are dealing with climate change and what we can do to help. And the aspect of climate change that's particularly important here is not the climate changing itself, it's a consequence of that, which is that sea levels are rising. So this comes from a study that was done 10 years ago now, and each of these different lines represents different possible futures for sea levels across the planet. There's a lot going on here, but there's two key points that I want you to take note. First of all is this bottom line, this kind of gray dash line. That is what was predicted, 10 years ago, to be what would happen with sea level rise if all carbon emissions stopped in 2016. Now that didn't happen. We're not going to get close to that, but even if we had managed to stop all carbon emissions, sea level rise would continue through the next century. The second take-home message is that the rest of the lines are a whole bunch of things with lots of acronyms that denote different types of policy scenarios that the world could take. And we don't know which of those will happen. We're starting to get a clearer idea. We're starting to take it a little bit more seriously. But what you should notice here is that for the first kind of 50 years through 2060, 2070, there's really no difference between them in terms of what happens with sea level rise. Now the main reason for those two things is that a lot of what is going to happen with sea level rise is not due to what we do in the future, it's due to what we've already done. A big part of sea level rise is expansion of the oceans. Water just, you heat it up, it takes up more space. And we've already put so much carbon into the atmosphere and warmed the atmosphere enough for that process to be in place but continuing. So there's going to be this legacy effect of the warming that has already happened that will play out over the next few decades. And that's why it doesn't really matter what the policy is. This warming is all due to stuff that we've already done. Now, that doesn't mean that we shouldn't pay attention to policy and that we shouldn't be doing stuff, because over the longer term, it does make big differences. But we can be pretty sure we're going to see this much, at least this much sea level rise over the next few centuries. That's, you know, half a meter or so, and that doesn't sound like a lot, but when you're in a marsh, and whether your nest is here or here, makes a difference of whether you get to reproduce. It has huge repercussions. And so that's a big part of what I'll talk about. So my talk is kind of divided into three parts. I'll talk about the birds, I'll tell you a little bit about their natural history, and what we've learned about that from a conservation perspective. And I'll talk about their habitat, because you can't do conservation without thinking about the system in which these birds exist. And then I'll talk about the role that we play in trying to do something about this. So I'll talk a lot about saltmarsh sparrows. Saltmarsh sparrow is the species that kind of got us started on this work. But it's in no way the only species that we're studying. We're interested in the entire system. We're interested in all of the species that live in it. And we're particularly interested in these four species in addition to saltmarsh sparrows. These are specialists. They almost exclusively occur in coastal marshes. One of the things that we're trying to figure out is, does what happened to saltmarsh sparrow tell us something about what happens to this whole set of species? So we've got clapper rails, eastern willets, the Acadian, Nelson's sparrow, and then seaside sparrow. These four and saltmarsh sparrow, that group of five are these tidal marsh specialist species that really are dependent on this system. Saltmarsh sparrow, as I said, is kind of central to everything that we do. A couple of just key things about this species: it's one of the very few bird species that is completely restricted to the United States. Anyone know the others? Well, we can talk about that later. They breed from Virginia to Maine, but in this very, very narrow strip of habitat along the coast, they are only found in salt marshes. And they nest only in the higher elevation parts of the marsh. And that may sound like a weird thing, you know, marshes, they don't have high, you know, they don't have like mountains, they don't have high elevations. But you can see in this picture, you know, the grass looks a little different. I guess I have a pointer. Should have done that. On this side, the grass looks a little different from over here. That's because it's that few centimeters, a couple of inches different in elevation. So the different plants grow there. And I can tell you that you would never find a saltmarsh sparrow nest here. But you could easily find one here, even though it's only, you know, a few meters away. And so they are restricted to salt marshes, but they're also restricted to a tiny portion of those marshes, only certain the microhabitats within the larger system. And so we've been studying these birds for a long time in Connecticut. I started back in 2002. Other people have been studying them even longer. Peter's sitting right here, who's studying them here in Rhode Island before we started in Connecticut. And we've worked in a lot of different marshes. We've caught a lot of birds. We've banded them. We've tracked them. We've looked at their survival. We found lots and lots of nests. And we've taken all kinds of data on them. We've taken mug shots so that we know who's who. We've measured them in lots of different ways. We have a lot of information about their basic biology. I'm mostly not going to talk about that today, although I'm happy to answer questions, because they have some really interesting biological traits that are quite unusual. In particular, the fact that they don't have pairs, they don't have territories. The females do all of the parental care. They lay the eggs, raise the kids. Entirely on their own. The females mate with multiple males, so if you have a nest with five chicks in it, there could be four fathers involved. Lots of things that are very unusual for songbirds. But this is the conservation side of the work that I'm going to talk about. So we find the nests. When we find nests, we track what goes on. We revisit them frequently to figure out how long they survive, if they do survive. If they don't survive, what the cause of failure was. Is it because the nest's flooded? On a high tide, or is it because of predation, or some other thing. We've also put little transmitters on birds. You can see this little transmitter here, to track their migration. And there's this great kind of cooperative program called MODIS, where people across all of North America and increasingly other parts of the world have these receiver towers, where they put up an antenna with a little receiver on it. And then if a bird with a certain type of tag flies by, the MODIS tower can detect detect that bird and tell you that it was in that area. These towers occur all over the place. This is from a few years ago. But you can get one of these circles, shows the location of the tower. And then the lines that are starting to appear, those are the tracks that were taken by birds that we tagged back in, I don't know, 8 or 9 years ago now. For 2 or 3 years, we were tagging these birds in Maine, Massachusetts, and here in Rhode Island. And so we were able to figure out from this the speed of migration, where they stop along the way, and so on. So we have lots and lots of basic natural history information from this work. One of the most important things to know about their biology, though, is that they live in these marshes where tidal flooding happens frequently. So this is Hammonasset State Park. Many of you may, if you kind of dare to cross the border into Connecticut, you may have been here. If you chase the Townsend solitaire, it's hanging out right up here in the campground. And you can see from these two pictures, and this is one of the biggest marshes in Connecticut. It's one of the most important sites for saltmarsh sparrows, certainly in Connecticut, maybe in southern New England. It's a pretty big marsh by Connecticut standards. But you can see that it really changes. This is not kind of an extreme hurricane type event. This is just a pretty big high tide. It's kind of spring tides that happen on a monthly basis. This is a pretty big one, but you know, we get these high tides frequently, and when they happen, they cover a lot of the marsh. And you can imagine, you're a female sparrow and you have a nest right here. On this big high tide, your nest is right here, and it's probably underwater. And you know, that's not good. So I have a video here, I think I may need a chance to play this. It's kind of purple because this is taken at night. Often the highest tides happen at night. And you see the nest and the eggs, and you can see it filling up with water. As the tide comes up, it's sped up. This is about 90 minutes. The water's now going back down. And at the end of it, you'll see the bird comes back in, sits back down in the nest, warms those eggs back up again, and they're fine. Now, these birds have evolved in this system. They've evolved in tidal flooding, and they can handle it because the eggs are not underwater for very long. So they certainly cool, but they can be warmed back up again and frequently hatch. And we've shown that some of these nests flood eight, nine times. Almost all nests flood at least a couple of times in the nesting cycle. And they survive. They produce young. It's not a problem. But if the flooding is too extreme, if the water gets too high, two things can happen. One is that if there's eggs, eggs will float, especially when they're close to developing. They float out of the nest. And so the nest is here, the eggs are here. Saltmarsh sparrows, it's not very far away. Birds don't have hands. They don't have a way to pick it up and put it back. So it's a dead egg. And so eggs get lost for this reason. And then chicks are a little bit more flexible. This one, in this case, the nest is down here underwater. But this chick has climbed out up in the vegetation and is just kind of hanging out. And again, because this is tidal flooding, it's not, there's a big flood and the water sits there for the next few days. It's tidal flooding, so the tide goes up and then it comes back down again. It's only an hour, so the birds can climb out, they can hang out up in the vegetation, fly back down to the nest afterwards. But they can't do this when they're little. You know, these birds, it takes them a week to get to the point where they've developed enough that they're able to do this. So for that first week of their lives, they're vulnerable, and if the nest is completely underwater, the chicks just drown. So as I said earlier, you know, tides have been going up. This is more local. These are data from the mouth of the Thames River in New London, and you can see that over the past few decades there's been this progressive increase in sea levels. And this is replicated for every tide gauge up and down the coast. And so understanding how the birds interact with this tidal flooding is just central to everything about their biology. And it's especially important to the conservation issues. So what I'm going to show here is a little graphic to show how tides fluctuate over the course of a month. This is the lunar cycle. We get particularly high tides on the new moons and the full moons. Not only the tides go up and down daily, but they also peak at certain times in the lunar cycle. You know, right around here and right around here, every 2 weeks. And that's what we refer to as spring tides. You might have heard of spring tides. They have nothing to do with the spring, the season, but they so tides go up and down every day. That's what all this kind of crazy up and down is. These really extreme high tides are so high that there's nowhere in the marsh that birds can safely nest. But then there's this window. There's another peak here, but usually the intermediate peaks are not as extreme as the ones here and here. And usually there's this period in which the birds can nest. It takes them 23, 24 days to get through the nesting cycle. So it's tight, you know, it's a 28-day cycle with extremes here and here, and but you can usually get a nesting cycle in between because you've got those 25 days that it takes to lay eggs, incubate them, and get the chicks big enough to get out of the nest. But if we raise the sea level a little bit, then suddenly these intermediate periods, these intermediate tides are also flooding nests. They're also high enough to cause a problem. And then the width or the number of days here and here, the number of days that will cause flooding expands. And so suddenly this window gets narrowed. And if it gets narrowed enough, the birds simply can't reproduce. And this is the fundamental problem that these birds face, is that if the relative sea level rise goes up just a little bit, it can push to this point where reproduction just stops. And if you don't get to have babies, you don't get to be around any longer. Okay, so we kind of have this natural history kind of grounding in their biology. And we want to know, how is climate change going to affect these birds? We know that there's good potential for sea level rise to have a problem. But the question is, does it actually create a problem? How serious is that problem? And what can we do about it? So we've been, about 12 years ago, we started this collaborative effort we call SHARP. Myself and a bunch of colleagues at several other universities throughout the Northeast. Over this time, we've had a whole bunch of grad students come through our labs, various postdocs, and they've done all the actual work. We've had a lot of different organizations have supported parts of this, and many of them are indicated over here on these logos, and a lot of organizations have helped fund this. So this is, you know, I'm the mouthpiece here, but this is work that's being done by a lot of different people through this collaboration, and this is one kind of iteration of our group from one of our annual kind of research meetings. And I've highlighted four people in particular because a lot of the data and the analyses that I'm going to draw on in the rest of my talk were done by these people. So Chris Field here, who is a PhD student in my lab, Mo Corral, Kate Ruskin, who were up at the University of Maine in Orono. Mo Corral here now works for the Fish and Wildlife Service and is responsible for much of the work that's being done around saltmarsh sparrow conservation across the entire East Coast. And then Brian Klingbeil was a postdoc in my lab as well. But everyone here has contributed to this stuff in lots of different ways. I don't have time to talk about everybody. And so when we kind of formed this collaboration, the idea was that as a group, collectively across the entire region, we can gather a lot more information than any one of us can do on our own. And so we've been able to put together this series of studies that looks across the entire Northeast at what's going on for saltmarsh sparrow, but also for all of these other birds that use these marshes. And so one side of the work we do is focused on surveying. You know, we have these locations, we've got thousands of places where we've done these point counts, similar to Charles was talking about earlier, where you just go out, you stand in one place, you count the number of birds in a fixed amount of time, and then you can use that information to estimate how many birds there are in a given area. So we've done this across the Northeast. And we did this in 2011, 2012. We surveyed these thousands of points. We had some historic data that we were able to pull together from other studies, and we were able to estimate population trend, and we found that saltmarsh sparrows have declined by about a little bit over 70% over the last, or less than 20 years. And this was 10 years ago that we did this. So we lost 3/4 of the world population. You know, we're surveying almost the entire global population of species. 3/4 of them lost in less than 20 years. We just finished last year a repeat of that survey. So we did this in 2011, 2012. We repeated 2021, 2022. We're in the middle of figuring out whether this decline is continuing at the same pace, whether it's slowed. estimated the global population size back in 2011, 2012. We estimated there were about 50 to 60,000. You know, there's some uncertainty there, but that's just kind of a sense of the size of the population. If they continue to decline at that rate, there's probably less than 30,000 now. That's fewer individuals than there are in the Asian elephant population. If you think of that as kind of a benchmark or an indicator of conservation, a thing we pay attention to in terms of conservation. But again, we're still cranking the numbers. I say we. One of the graduate students in my lab is still cranking the numbers to figure out what the current population size is. So the survey stuff tells us something about number of birds and population trend. It doesn't tell us much about what the causes of any declines or increases are. To understand that, we have to get into more detail about that biology. And so the other half of our program focuses on what we call these demographic plots, where we're collecting demographic data like reproductive rates, the number of offspring that are produced each year, that are produced by each female. And we're looking at the survival rates of adults. And if you know something about birth rates and something about death rates, you can understand what will happen to the population trend, because you want to be replacing all of those deaths with births in order for the population to be stable. But you can also start to understand why populations are changing and therefore what you can do about it. So we catch birds, we band them, we take measurements. When we recapture them, that's how we estimate survival, because if we keep recatching the same bird, we know it's still alive, and we can use that information to estimate population-wide survival. We find nests, we track their survival, so we know how many young are being produced from each nest and how to use that. And we've done this at lots of sites. We actually have more sites than are shown on this map now, but we've worked at many, many sites, over 30, 35 sites now, where we collected this kind of data and found many, you know, hundreds of nests, thousands of birds found it. And unlike the point count data, we don't have much in the way of historical information. There are some older studies. They tend to be just in a few locations. So I have this little imperfect comparisons note. That means that's my kind of get out of free jail card if I'm wrong about this. But we do have some historic estimates, and so we're able to compare what those early studies show to what we're finding. And so that historic stuff is in blue, and these are, you know, four different estimates. It's all from a single site in this case. But we have four different estimates of how likely it is that a nest will survive to produce at least one offspring. So that's one measure of reproductive success. And then in red, we have the data from all of our sites. Now, some of our sites look about as good as the historic sites. Many of them are worse. Now, it could be that back in the old day, there were lots of sites that were worse as well, and we just don't know because nobody went and studied them there. So this isn't necessarily bad. But if you have nest survival rates that are down in the, you know, about 20%, that's pretty low. I mean, that's not a good sign. You know, birds can re-nest, so maybe it's not terrible, but it's suggestive of a problem. We also have some other measures of reproductive success. So this is the number of successful nests each female produced, and we only pay attention to females because of that thing about them doing all the reproductive work. You know, the males are completely irrelevant, pretty much, in this system. So it's the number of nests a female can get through. And it used to be that they would, on average, produce at least one successful nest every year. Again, limited data, so we don't know how representative this is. But we do know that every single one of the sites we've studied recently is not doing that well. And then finally, this is the number of young produced per female. So, you know, now we're trying to say, does each individual replace itself? And this is per year, so it's not a perfect measure. We ideally like to know that across the lifespan of the individual. But again, the historic data, with all of the caveats in place, suggests that they used to be producing a lot more young per female than at any of our current sites. So as I say, there's lots of caveats here, but the story seems to be that reproductive success is not as good as it used to be. The other kind of half of the equation, as I mentioned, we care about births. Your birth rate can decline if your survival rate is increasing, because you back from say, kind of the 60s and 70s through much more recent. But again, each of these is only from like one small site, just individual places in the range. This is an estimate across all of our sites across the entire range. And you know, is this different? Probably not. The bar plots kind of indicate the fact that we're uncertain about exactly what the number is, but it's somewhere in this range. There's two different bars here overlapping, one for males, one for females. But you know, this is perhaps not worse, but it's certainly not better. It's certainly not improved in a way that might compensate for a decline in the ability to reproduce. So there's a ton of stuff going on here, so they're fairly complicated graphs. But the suggestion here is that reproduction maybe has gotten worse, and survival has not improved to compensate for that. And so therefore, we should be worrying about what's going on with reproduction. That's probably the key to the decline. And then, you know, this is, I'm going to get back to some nice pictures of birds in a moment, I apologize. But we've also taken all of the numbers that we had and built these models, these computer models, that predict what will happen to the population in the different scenarios. And there are two different types of things here that are both fairly simple. This first one with all these, this is simply what we would expect to see if that 9% per year decline continued into the future. So we estimated that they're declining about 9% per year. If you have trouble figuring what that means, think about your stock portfolio declining 9% per year in the future. Some people get it. So rapidly, you lose population. And so what we see here, this is a very simplistic way of looking at it, but it suggests that you know by 2050 they're gone, essentially. So that's one way of thinking about it from the survey data. The other way is to use a completely different set of information, this information on birth rates and death rates, and especially on nesting success. And that's what the top line is. And so on this axis, we have the probability that these birds have one of those 24 day long breeding windows. If they don't have that, if that doesn't exist because of sea level rise, that reproduction stops. And so we were able to estimate the probability of that happening in a given year. And it stays good. You know, you want it to be here. You want it there to be at least one period in the summer when they can reproduce. Probability of that happening is 100% right the way through to here, and then it plummets. And this lines up pretty closely. It suggests that, again, right around 2050, mid-century, they're not going to be able to reproduce anymore. So we have two completely independent sets of data suggesting that this is when they're likely to go extinct. And that's not very far off. We made this graph quite a long time ago. I always like to point out that we're already here. When we did our survey, we were up there at 60,000. If that rate of decline is continuing, we're now down to maybe 20-25. We suspect it's not quite that bad. And that's not because things have gotten better for these birds. It's because if you get closer to zero, you know, there's nowhere to go. At some point, the rate of decline has to slow down because you're getting down to zero. Okay, so I know most people in this room care, but not everybody does care about sparrows. And often, especially not some weird little marsh sparrow that even a lot of birders haven't seen. That we can't just change the way we think about managing our entire coast because of this one bird. So I want to talk in the next piece of the presentation about the larger system and what this bird tells us about it. Because even though I do care about sparrows a lot, a big part of why I'm doing this is not because of so much sparrows. It's because it's because there's this larger system, this larger problem that we need to think about. I used to call my talks Canary in Saltmarsh. And then other people started using that, so I don't use it anymore. But I still think it's a great analogy for why we should think about these birds. You know, back in the day, miners would take canaries down to the coal mines with them because the canaries were staying and staying and staying unless there was a buildup of carbon dioxide, and the canary would keel over before the people did. So that point at which the bird stopped singing and the birds lying in the bottom of the cage was a sign to the miners that they should get out of the mines. So these birds, they were indicators of bad conditions. And you know, we think that these Saltmarsh sparrows and some of the other species can tell us similar things about what's going on in these marshes. So I said we studied all these other birds as well. I haven't told you much about them. But we know that Saltmarsh sparrows are declining at 9% a year. Those same surveys tell us that clapperels and Nelson sparrows are also declining, not nearly as severely, but even a 4%, 4.5% per year decline. Again, think about that stock portfolio. That is not good. Willets and seaside sparrows, we didn't find any evidence of decline back in our earlier survey, but we have seen indications in some of our other data that at least in certain places, especially near the edges of their geographic range, the northern edge, there are signs that they might be starting to decline as well. And so we're kind of eager to see what happens from this more recent survey. So it sure seems that Saltmarsh sparrows are the worst case scenario, but they do seem to be indicating something about what's happening to at least some of the other birds in the system. They're actually not the worst case scenario. This is a black rail. The best way to get a photograph was to steal this picture of one. And black rails also live in marshes, or at least they used to, in these coastal marshes. And we don't know hardly anything about black rails even now. They're incredibly hard to study. People are starting to get some bits of information. We don't really know why they declined, but if you look at the history of their decline and you look at where they used to nest in coastal marshes, it sure looks like what is happening to Saltmarsh sparrow now is probably what happened to black rails about 40, 50 years ago. And yet we just weren't there documenting it. Now, it's not the only part of the story for black rails, because black rails also nest in inland freshwater marshes and stuff. So there's clearly other things going on. But the decline of black rails, at least in my mind, is probably a precursor to the decline of Saltmarsh sparrow. And I suspect that Saltmarsh sparrow is a precursor to what we'll see with clappers and seasides, or clappers and Nelsons, and then maybe eventually also willets and seasides. So I just kind of see this kind of sequence of birds dropping out of these marshes based on their relative vulnerabilities. And of course, it's not just about birds. You know, lots and lots of people live near the coast, and their lives are affected very severely. This picture shows what it looks like on a king tide in parts of coastal New England, and this is terrible and it's not good for people. But globally, there's 100 million people live within a meter of sea level rise. I mean, that's the potential for sea level rise to disrupt lives, disrupt entire countries by creating forced migration of people. And of course, much of this is happening in countries that are far more impoverished than where we are, and where it's not just your basement that gets flooded, it's you lose your entire livelihood or your entire home. So there is this bigger context within which this work lives. Okay, so marshes. I'm going to talk a little bit about the marshes and the habitat. So in addition to the bird declines, we've also documented a lot of changes in the marshes that they live in. This is, again, another complicated figure, but basically what we have here are data for three different plant species that are common in coastal marshes. For each of them, there's a series of black bars. Each bar represents data from a single marsh complex going from west to east across the coast of Connecticut. And the bars represent how much of this plant species has changed over the, and this was between the early 2000s and 2013. And what you can take home from this is that this plant, Juncus gerardii, which occurs in relatively dry conditions, it occurs at high elevations, it can't cope with a lot of flooding, has declined systematically pretty much everywhere. So the things that don't like flooding are declining. At the same time, Spartina alterniflora, which can handle a lot more flooding, tends to be found at lower elevations in marshes, has increased pretty much everywhere. And then Spartina patens is kind of it's a relatively high elevation plant, but it's somewhat intermediate between these two, and it's more of a mixed bag. But systematically across all of these marshes, there's this signal that plants that like wet conditions are doing better, plants that like dry conditions are doing worse, which is consistent with what you'd expect if the marshes are getting wet and flooding more frequently. The whole system is you know, experiencing the effects of sea level rise more seriously. So the system is changing in addition to these effects on these individual birds. One consequence of that in some places is that marshes are moving. So many of you have maybe traveled south. This is from Virginia, but you can see this in Delaware and New Jersey and many points south, where the marshes move up into the forest, or the flooding moves up into the forest, the trees all die, and the marsh grasses move in, and you see what people refer to as these ghost forests. Now, this certainly happens. It happens extensively in some places. We don't fully understand all the processes, although people are increasingly studying this. We also don't really know just how widespread it is, although we're starting to get a bad handle on that. When we looked for this in New England, though, we did this big survey of coastal New England and coastal Connecticut and the North Shore of New York. We found that there's actually not much of it happening here. It certainly does happen. This is a spot at Barn Island, which you may know, Barn Island Wildlife Management Area. This was the place where I was first shown this what we call Saltmarsh migration or Saltmarsh transgression, where the marsh grasses are moving up into the forest understory. I was taken here when I first started studying these birds as an example of this process, and so this is happening everywhere. It turns out that this is where everybody gets taken to see this process, because there's quite a few places where it's really obvious. And when we did kind of a systematic survey all up and down the coast, we found very little sign of this. It does happen, but it just doesn't happen extensively over big areas in the way that it does in some places from south. So we also did a whole bunch of studies to figure out how quickly it happens, and it happens slowly. I mean, it has to happen. You know, if the sea level goes up, it has to move inland at some rate. But it's really a question of how quickly is it going to happen, and how quickly is that forest going to turn into marsh? And at least in New England, it seems to be pretty slowly. And so what that means is that we know that the vegetation in the marshes is changing because the marshes are getting wetter, so that good high elevation marsh where the birds can nest is declining in the marshes. And it is moving into the uplands, but it's moving very, very slowly. And so you're gradually diminishing the amount of it. And so we call this coastal squeeze. The habitat is getting squeezed out of existence. And then everything that relies on it is going to get squeezed out as well, including, you know, all of these birds, as well as saltmarsh sparrow and lots of other things that have been in the marshes. And to kind of look at this again, you know, big picture regionally, we've taken various projections of what is expected to happen in the future, looked across all of these states, and the pink bars represent the area of marsh we have now, and then this is how much we can be certain will still be around in 2050. Now, there's a lot of uncertainty. This does not mean that it will definitely decline to this rate, because there's lots of marshes where we just don't really know. But we're trying to be conservative here. We're saying, what's the proportion that we can be very confident will still be around? And it's not very much. And then the orange bars show how many birds occur in those places. So this is how many birds currently occur in this much marsh. If you lose all of these, it will decline until it's just this many birds left. And so you can see kind of how that changes across the state. Obviously, states like Connecticut, Rhode Island, they're smaller states, so they have less marsh. But we're seeing this consistent pattern everywhere. Much of the marsh is at best, its future is uncertain. And that means that the same is true for the birds that live there. And this kind of looks at that in a different way. The previous graph looked at it geographically. Now we're looking at it from the perspective of each species of birds. There's two bars for each species. Just ignore that. They're just two different mathematical ways of estimating it. The story is the same in each of them. And again, we find that the total amount of marsh is likely to decline to maybe about 15-20%, or at least there's only 15-20% that we can be certain will still be around, and that amount of marsh will support this amount of birds. So we can anticipate big declines, that is really the bottom line, and across all of these. Okay, so what can we do? So this is what happens. You know, water comes. birds are sitting in the water if they're lucky. And so this is where we get to the people part of this. You know, this is a problem we created. You know, these birds have been handling flooding for millennia. But this decline is rapid and it's completely coincident with climate change. So we can do all the kind of standard things that we do in conservation. We can identify priority areas, places. These are maps of parts of, I think this is part of the Chesapeake. We have different colors which represent where the saltmarsh is, and if it's red, that means it's protected. So we can protect places where there are a lot of birds. But because of climate change, we also have to be thinking about where the birds will be in 20 years' time, where they'll be in 30 years' time, where they'll be in 50 years' time, because these habitats are going to move. You know, it's the traditional way of doing reserve selection is you identify really good places, you protect them, and that's great. But if they're not going to be the great places in 50 years, you have to be thinking ahead and trying to figure out where those good places are going to be, how the birds are going to move there. Birds, it's pretty easy for them to move there, they can fly. But if they are dependent on certain plants, because those plants produce the food that they need, how are the plants going to get there? Because plants, you know, I guess the ones that produce seeds that get blown around in colonies, gets blown around kind of fly, but many of them don't fly. And so we have to be thinking about that future planning piece as well. And we also have to be thinking, you know, because that's really hard and very uncertain whether it will work, we also have to be thinking about how we can improve these habitats or at least maintain them in a condition that is good for birds, and that leads to various types of management activity. And this is just kind of three of the main types. There's a lot of variation. Some of you might recognize this. This is sedimentous, where sediment has been added to the marsh, and people are increasingly doing this in lots of places. You know, you put sediment on, that raises up the elevation. Sometimes it's coupled with planting out grasses to kind of speed up the rate of revegetation. People are also doing things like putting in living shorelines, these reef balls. What they essentially do is as the water comes in, they hit the reef balls and it slows down the rate of flow. If the water is moving more slowly, more of the sediment in it will fall out, and that helps build up the marsh elevation. And in this particular site, this is Stratford Point in Connecticut, spartina grasses were planted behind the reef balls, and you can see they're doing really well, that's good. But they were also planted over here. And these ones are not doing very well. So these reef balls, the effect that they're having in slowing down the water is really helping speed up the rate of revegetation. And then you can do things to alter the hydrology, you know, taking out tide gates, modifying tide gates so that they influence the extent to which high water flows into marshes and so on. These restorations are happening all up and down the coast, and we've been studying a lot of them, collecting data before they happen as a baseline, and then continuing to monitor them after that happens to see how they change, which restoration methods work. One of the problems here is many of these restoration methods have only been around for a few years. You know, we don't know if they work. You know, to save or rebuild a marsh, that's a many year, perhaps couple of decade process. So we have to try lots of different things because we don't know what will work, and we can be pretty sure some things won't work. So we need to be experimenting. And so that's what, here we're mostly just monitoring these different projects to figure out what happens to the birds, and perhaps more importantly, at least in the short term, what happens to the vegetation, because if we don't have the vegetation, we know we're not going to get the birds, and the vegetative response is faster. This is a picture down at Stratford, Great Meadows in Connecticut, where there's a big project that we're involved in. And at this site, we're doing experiments with, in this case, different types of sediment to see whether the type of sediment you use affects the rate at which revegetation happens. I have two great collaborators here, Beth Lawrence, who's a wetland plant ecologist, and Ashley Helton, who's a biogeochemist. And through their work and their students' work, we're monitoring greenhouse gases in these areas. You know, marshes both store carbon, but they could also produce and kick out greenhouse gases. And so if we're doing all this restoration, that's great. But if as a result we're generating greenhouse gases, like methane and nitrous oxide, we could be making the situation worse. So we're trying to understand those aspects of these restorations as well. And so here, those same plots a little bit later in the summer, you can see the grasses are growing back in. And then at the same site, there is the bigger restoration work, larger areas. in an area where there are saltmarsh sparrows nesting, and so we have just started a project to monitor the effects on those birds. We're going to put transmitters on them and see how they move around, because you know there's a lot of good things that come with restoration, but it also causes disruption. And so we want to know if it's creating any negative effects, as well as whether the birds are responding positively. And this is a really good site to do that, because there are birds there, but it's not such a big population that if it does go horribly wrong, it would have a really serious impact. And so this is one of those bigger plots, this kind of hollow sediment, and you can see the planted grasses. And if you look very carefully, here there's a pile of sticks. Well, it's a pile of sticks with a bird sitting in it. And so you know, sparrows are not using these areas yet, but even 1 year in, we do have bullets nesting up on these higher elevation spots within the marsh. So to kind of wrap this up, you know, again, I'm the mouthpiece here. There's a lot of work being done by an awful lot of different people, both within our group, mostly on the research side. Much of the management is being done by state agencies and federal agencies, like the Fish and Wildlife Service. And this document by the Atlantic Coast Joint Venture, which kind of pulls together all those people, lays out a plan for all the different things we should be looking at and thinking about if we're to protect saltmarsh birds. And it's a view across the entire East Coast. So with that, I would be happy to take any questions. Job that was great when everyone had typewriters. But if conditions change, no one has typewriters anymore, you don't have a job anymore. And it's kind of an analogous to what's going on with these birds. They're specialists, they can get into this niche. It's really hard to live in salt marshes. The tides, the salinity, that all makes it kind of a difficult place for a terrestrial organism to live. And these birds have figured out how to live there. But the conditions are changing, and they're changing so fast that now they're kind of stuck in this kind of highly specialized set of conditions which are disappearing. Yeah.
Is it most of the development of grass phragmites doing a job to the marshes?
Yeah, so phragmites is this invasive plant. You've probably seen it. It's like this tall. It's everywhere. It's certainly a problem in a lot of places, but it's a problem that people have been working with for decades, and there are good control methods. Control has to be done. This great meadow site has phragmites. They have to control it through a variety of means and the different methods used in different places. So it certainly has potential to be a problem, but as long as you have the money to manage it, it can be managed. And it also tends to occur, it can't handle the really salty conditions. And you tend to find it in freshwater marshes, in brackish water, kind of the edges of salt marshes. If the marshes are open to the ocean, getting a lot of salt water, that alone will control phragmites. In Long Island Sound, it's tricky because it's not true seawater. You know, it's fresher than seawater, but it's still not fresh water. And so it is a problem in some places. Yeah.
You had a slide that showed three plant species.
Mm-hmm.
Could you give me the common name of the plant in the middle?
Oh, spontaneous patent, salt head. It has a lot of common names, but
okay.
It's probably one of the, it's a grass that used to be harvested for cattle.
Yep.
For grazing.
Thank you.
Yeah.
One of your slides near the end had red dots.
Yeah.
And one of them was in Narragansett Bay. Where is that?
That might be Statuist and not very well placed.
Statuist.
That would be my guess.
All right, thanks.
We have so many of these sites. I know the ones that I actually do field work at, but I'm not visiting
them. Work at Statuist and on the Narrow River and then also Galilee.
Yeah.
That would be my guess if there would be study sites.
Yeah. Yes.
So you mentioned how slowly the salt marsh expands. We've all certainly heard about coastal development being an issue. But is it really an issue if marsh just can't move faster? That is, what should be our position, even from a carbon perspective of the salt marshes taking up carbon, for coastal development with, you know, housing and so on?
Well, it depends. Because there are multiple things that affect the movement of the marshes. A big one is topography. You know, if the slope goes like that, there's no way the marsh can ever go down. And so in those cases, at least from a marsh protection point of view, you could argue that preventing development is unnecessary. There's lots of other reasons you should prevent that development. I mean, coastal forests are an issue, coastal grasses are an issue. Perhaps even more important than that, if you put in houses, you get nitrogen runoff, and you get other kinds of problems, and that does change marshes. You know, there's really good evidence that suggests that nitrogen runoff, which is what happens every time you put fertilizer on your lawn, you are putting nitrogen, it's going to run off into the ocean, in the coastal area, or into the rivers. That has dramatic effects on marshes and causes them to collapse and that kind of problems. So there are other reasons, but from a pure could marsh move into this area, if the topography doesn't allow it, then it's not a big deal. All of our data come from places where the topography, at least in theory, should allow it. And it is a slow process, but if you only cared about saltmarsh sparrow, you could say, well, they'll be extinct by then, so it's not a big deal. But if you care about the larger system and you just want to have marshes in the future, and there's lots of reasons for wanting that, then it's still, there are good reasons for not developing right up against it. Plus, you know, this is not going away. This is nothing to decline. If you build your house right against the water, you're going to have to deal with flooding. I mean, that's going to affect you. It's going to affect your insurance, it's going to affect your resale value in 30 years' time. It just doesn't seem very wise to me. That's just my take. Yeah.
I just had a related question about how one affects like chemical contamination, nutrient contamination, interact with sea level rise and kind of things like marshes have been manipulated a lot. They're in the haven and stuff, which is ditch, all changed to marsh. And how does that interact?
We've ditched all these marshes. You know, pretty much every marsh in Southern New England is ditched. That actually probably was good for saltmarsh sparrows because it probably dried out the marshes, and people have argued that there's more high elevation marsh habitat as a result of that. That doesn't change the fact that they're now going extinct, and if we want them to be around, we have to do things. But that might have been a good thing historically. But ditches also, they affect the nature of the draining, they affect the hydrology. In a lot of places, people are trying to remove those ditches and fill them in. What other things did you mention? You mentioned contaminants. Well, nitrogen is a big one. So nitrogen is shown to create changes in the ability for different plant species to compete with each other, so it changes the plant community. In some cases, it literally causes the mud to collapse. There's been some entire marsh size experiments done in Massachusetts that suggest or to show that. What else has been done in these marshes? Spraying for mosquitoes is a thing. That doesn't seem to have any effects on the birds, but it could. Certainly affects the insects and
mercury. In the Northeast, many river systems have a lot of mercury in them, and the marsh is aware of what mercury is right now. So we've looked at mercury in birds across the Northeast, and it occurs at pretty high levels in female saltmarsh sparrows. We have a little bit of evidence that it affects reproductive success, but it's a tiny effect compared to the effect of flooding. So, you know, I guess the ecotic toxicology people who were involved in the work were really excited. They were like, oh, there's an effect here. But in the context of all the other things that birds deal with, it's kind of, at least in my view, it's kind of trivial. So there are a lot of other competing parts. But the overriding thing that seems to be affecting at least saltmarsh sparrow the most is flooding of their nests. That is what seems to be driving the decline. And that seems to be key to the problem. And that's not entirely due, or that could be due to things other than sea level rise, but the simplest explanation is that it's entirely, or very almost entirely due to sea level rise. Yes, Steve.
So saltmarsh sparrows and seaside sparrows, both at least in the Northeast, restricted to nesting in saltmarsh habitats subject to flooding, and yet their decline trajectories are different from your slides.
Mm-hmm.
Can you explain that?
I can wildly speculate about it. So we think that the reason, well, we know from studies in Connecticut that, well, let me back up. So you have high elevation marsh and low elevation marsh, and the differences are probably smaller than I'm showing here. Saltmarsh sparrows are more associated with the higher elevations. Seaside sparrows tend to be found more in the lower elevations. There's lots of overlap, you know, they could nest right next to each other. But you tend to find saltmarsh sparrows at slightly lower elevation marshes. Now that might make you think that they're more vulnerable, because lower elevations close to where sea level is. But the grasses that grow at lower elevations actually are much taller. So Spartina alternifora is the kind of cord grass that is most common at low elevations, and it can grow this tall. It's regularly this tall. Okay. Spartina patens, which grows at higher elevations, is about this tall. And so the seaside sparrows can actually nest higher relative to sea level rise than the saltmarsh sparrows can. It's small. It's on average, a couple of inches. It's a small difference. But that might make all the difference. But that's also part of why I think that, you know, if we just wait another couple of decades, seaside sparrows are going to be going in the same direction. So that's our best guess. We just did a big analysis, and this is not published. One of the PhD students in my lab is going to be defending a dissertation next week, and it's part of her work. Where we looked at all of the nesting data across the entire region, and that analysis, and she did this for all of the different species, and that shows that seaside sparrows have a slightly higher nest survival rate than saltmarsh, maybe 10% higher, but that could be just enough to kind of give them that edge, at least for now. Yeah.
Do you anticipate that it's possible that saltmarsh sparrows could start to move into ranges that are currently exclusively melting sparrows? Although if you're avoiding high tides, maybe you don't want to move into the Bay of Fundy.
Nelson's doing okay in the Bay of Fundy. And there's actually these big impoundments. There's a grad student up at the University of New Brunswick who's doing some really interesting work on these impounded areas which don't fly, and the Nelson's least seem to use them. So in theory that could happen. We don't see much evidence of it. The two species hybridize in that area. We actually see a little bit of evidence that the hybrid zone is expanding, both north and south. But that's probably not because of birds moving. It's probably not because of Nelson moving south. It's probably because, this is a bit complicated, it's probably because saltmarsh sparrows are declining faster than Nelsons are declining. So the ratio of Nelsons to saltmarsh sparrow is changing in a way that makes it more likely that they will interbreed. At least that's my idea for what's happening. And it's not a big difference, but there is a little bit of evidence of that. There are some subtle differences in habitat between the two species, and they kind of change about where the species transition is. And so that might limit the extent to which saltmarsh sparrows move. But we do have a couple of recent nests quite far north in Maine. In fact, I think one is in Lubeck, right up on the border. So there is a little bit of evidence of them moving north, but there's not that much saltmarsh up there, for one thing. And the rate of movement seems pretty slow. Again, if they had a couple of hundred years, that could happen. next 2 to 3 decades. I just don't see it. Yeah. Goodbye.
Do they have predators like fox on top of everything else going on?
Yeah. There's lots of predators. Everything from crabs eating the babies. On our videos, we have pictures of crabs coming in and eating mostly already drowned chicks, but. Right the way through, there's this nice study just came out from Rhode Island that shows that deer in the marshes will eat eggs and maybe young. And then all the kind of standard things you might think of, like raccoons and skunks and stuff, probably do at some level. We see much less nest predation in the northern part of the range than you see further south. Down in New Jersey, predation is a much, much more important part of the nest failure story. But there's also more predators, and especially more rodents in the marshes down there. Rice rats are pretty common. And we have a study where a student was studying the causes of nest failure in these New Jersey marshes the year before Hurricane Sandy and then the year after Hurricane Sandy, and showed that predation rates really changed dramatically. And the year after Hurricane Sandy, couldn't find any rice rats. Presumably they all drowned. But then within a year, the rice rat population went back up. And so the predation is certainly an issue, but it's more of a problem farther south. And the two things also interact. So there's some really nice research that's been done down in Georgia on seaside sparrows that suggests that seaside sparrows may nest higher in the vegetation if they nest higher in the vegetation to get away or to deal with flooding, then their nests may become more vulnerable to predators. I mean, certainly aerial predators are more likely to be able to see them, but they might just be easier to find. So there's also this kind of interaction between those two issues.
So that's kind of what I've been trying to figure out. In your data set for the nest placement, is there any change over time on adapting to the sea level, or are they just like genetically locked into that elevation?
We don't have much evidence for change except for this within season effect, where if a bird loses its nest, when it rebuilds, it might nest a couple of inches or a couple of centimeters higher. In terms of across years, we don't see that, but again, it's not clear that there's enough time for that kind of evolution to happen. Plus, there's not much of where they can go. I mean, they're already, if the grass is only this tall, they can't go higher than this. And we do find that saltmarsh sparrows do nest off the ground, and they'll be if the vegetation is taller, their nest will be higher off the ground. So that and that is not true for any of the other grassland nesting sparrows. They all nest right on the ground. So it looks like over evolutionary time, there has been some natural selection for them to get their nests up at least as far as they can go within the vegetation. But there's just this constraint that is just only so far.
What's the value of putting the nest right at that flood zone?
Well, presumably the value of these birds is there's nothing else nesting there. You're not competing with other species. I mean, that's that being a specialist thing. If you can figure out a way to live in the system and do okay in it, then you can use this really difficult environment, and you're not competing with lots and lots of other species. And as long as the system is stable, that works really well. But as soon as it changes, then unless the change is very gradual, it's hard to make those shifts. Yeah?
So on the topic of human intervention, we know that providing nest sites has helped with things like ospreys, for example. Has anybody researched providing artificial nesting habitats for these birds?
So we did some experiments where we tried to create floating salt marshes that would go up and down, and they sort of worked, but they weren't very convincing. I think it could be done. Whether it could be scaled up, so you have to be in enough areas to really make a difference, that seems very questionable to me. But we played around with that a little bit. There's a couple of places where people have experimented with raising the nests within the grasses, and you're just kind of pushing the grass up a little bit. Yeah, that could work, but again, it's super labor intensive. You have to find the nests, and it runs this risk of making those nests really obvious to predators. And an osprey could probably handle that
So that might work, and people are experimenting, and I think we should be experimenting even with some of these things that we're not sure will work, because we don't have a whole lot of time to figure it out, so we should be trying different things. But in general, I mean, you know, birds that just nest on a platform or nest in, you know, a tree or a nest in a cavity, we've shown it's really easy to make nests for those. Birds that build nests like this, I don't know of hardly any cases where people have effectively found ways to use them in conservation. Probably a couple of examples, but it's a very, very different story. And there's just not much evidence that we know how to do that. Yeah?
You said if the nest floods, they'll have another go at it.
Mm-hmm.
If a nest is successful, are they done for the year, or are they going to attempt a second clutch?
Well, it's a little hard to say. I mean, I would suspect that they would do multiple broods. It's really hard to tell from our data because it's so rare for a bird even to get one nest off that they just don't really have that opportunity. We have a few cases of second brooding. In theory, they could get three broods off it, and there's enough time in the summer. But certainly our study sites, you know, basically none of the May nests survive, hardly any of the June nests survive. In July, maybe we'll get some young. Some years we don't get hardly any young for the entire summer. You know, the story I tell, back in 2009, one of the first PhD students who was working in our group on this stuff, she had part of her study involved finding lots and lots of nests. She really needed to find a lot. She found over 210 nests at the two study sites she was working at that summer. They produced 9 fledglings. Now, part of the reason she found so many nests was because they kept re-nesting. They kept losing and having to re-nest. But that was in 2009. You know, and that was kind of it was a stormy year, so the tides were higher than expected. But to me, that was the real wake-up call. It's like, well, if a stormy year is enough to do this, then sea level rise is going to be doing this fairly soon. And we'll be doing it everywhere, every year, not just one, you know, particularly bad year. Yes?
Yeah, I'm just curious. Are there scientists looking at other than birds, the impact of the sea level rise in the marshes? And also, I was interested to know, what do the marsh birds, or the saltmarsh sparrows, what do they eat? So is there an impact on insects, if they're eating insects, I assume?
Yeah, so they eat all sorts of invertebrates, insects, spiders, little amphipods, which are put down in the mud, little marsh snails, they eat a lot of different things. People are doing some work. We've started a little bit of insect work, in the last year. That's much harder than studying birds, so we've been slow to do it. There are fewer people studying that, but there are potentially problems there. The general dogma is that, you know, salt marshes are full of invertebrates and food is not a problem. And that's probably true for these birds, but that could certainly change. But I suspect that the habitat will disappear before that. That will happen as a result of the habitat disappearing, I suspect. We don't really know. But yeah, there certainly are people studying it. In terms of other types of organisms, there's an endangered salt marsh shrew, I think, in Florida that's being studied, and sea level rise is having an effect there. On the west coast, there's a salt marsh harvest mouse that's endangered on the endangered species list that's vulnerable to sea level rise. So there are some other species. There's not very many vertebrates, terrestrial vertebrates, that live in marshes that aren't birds, but the ones that do seem to be having similar problems.
Yes. One more question.
What is their typical lifespan? So how many years does a female have investing to produce an offspring for a placenta?
So they're pretty typical for a songbird. About half the adults die every year. So you can math that out, but probably on average maybe 3 or 4 years is kind of, you know, occasionally that you'll get one that's 7 or 8 years old. But they're the 115-year-old humans of the population. But there's no evidence that their survival is that different from typical songbirds. It's kind of unknown. Well, please join me in thanking Chris.